Okay, so here we go. I think this announcement has been already done. So please note that my course always need not ask whatever is last exam till the last day. Okay, whatever has been taught is a part of the exam. And since it's a quiz, there will be some problems. So do bring calculators. We are last time did little ahead, but I'll just go back a bit. We actually made the field oxides. Either we made the FOX using low cost process of this kind, or we made SIT, shallow trench isolation. So either way, we have now isolated the areas for transistors. We clean everything on the wafer then, except the FOX, and then the silicon is also opened. Everything is clean. RCA clean is very thorough that time. Before any gate oxidation, the wafer has to be ultra clean. Okay, that's the major step for us for our MOS performance. So we etch back everything, clean it everything, and the wafer is now ready for gate oxides. And in our case right now I am talking of SiO2, but in other cases it can be high K, in which case it will be deposition process, but in this case it will be a thermally grown silicon dioxide. Typically it is depends on the technology node. It could be 20 angstrom to 100 angstroms, or even earlier higher. We used to have 300 angstroms of gate oxides. Typically these days in thin oxides are needed, 800 degrees centigrade, which has the lowest growth rate, probably is tried. Okay, and maybe so that you have enough time for oxidation. So we actually have grown, please remember that I forgot this. Before that we have done two things which is not shown here. One is channel implants, we did channel stoppers, and in that case we also did PNN implants for making threshold corrections. What I mean by threshold, I don't believe that N-well concentration here and during the processing later will remain same, and I want the VT to be at the adjusted but the surface concentrations. So I actually implanted NNP to get my N-channel and P-channel device. So here is after that implants have been done and everything cleaned up and all that, gate oxide has been grown. Please remember that this process, after this process, the gate oxide is never is going to be exposed again. And therefore this, as I keep saying, this is the process step which is very crucial for all future successes. Immediately after the gate oxide has been grown, we push the wafers into what we call as LPCVD reactor. LPCVD stands for low pressure CVD, and typically around 1000 angstroms of polysilicon is deposited. These days because of poly is not the best metallic system, we may try moly silicides, platinum silicide, tungstens. Many silicides have been tried. Moly is the most common one. And for this, right now I am talking of a standard process, so I say okay, polysilicon, okay, but in future processes this itself may get modified. Now after the poly has been deposited, which is around 1000 angstroms, we can either make an implant on this to make it by another masking step. I can make one side N-kind, other kind P-kind. Or we may not do it right now at all. Okay, that option I yesterday said, when I do source drain, it will be exposed and that time I will get whatever poly depositions I want, or poly dopings I want. Typically I am looking for less than 10 ohm per square as the sheet resistance when I have a good poly. Okay. So will P plus poly will have a lower sheet resistance or N plus poly? No, that is exactly why. I thought after so many days you realize this. What is the maximum concentration boron can give and what is the maximum concentration arsenic or phosphorus can give? So it is always preferred to have N plus poly running everywhere because it will have least sheet resistance. Okay, and therefore even if I for a P-channel device I will make P plus poly for the sake of gate. But connection from there will not be P plus poly. It will run on only connecting with N plus poly ahead everywhere. And that's most important, that the poly runners or poly interconnects are always N plus doped, preferably arsenic doped. Okay. But as I said, these days we are not looking for policy runners too much. We may do suicides, so it may not be that serious, but essentially poly is very crucial for N plus polys. One of course he said is not wrong, mobility has an issue, but the major thing is one order higher concentrations possible. Interconnect from one transistor to other. Poly will run, poly as a runner. Okay. First, you will have to start with gate, so there will be a poly. So, first layer may be a poly interconnect internally. Okay. If you do a design course, and maybe you must be doing it, you will say, unless there is a poly interconnect, we will have a difficulty in running metals. Okay. You need too many bridges then. Okay. So, the first runner is poly. First runner is poly. Runner is a word used in design for interconnect. Okay, so first runner is poly. Okay, so this was what we last time discussed. We have a poly which is either doped. I mean, some people dope it now, but most people don't. And doping, if at all has to be done, is either by implant or by solid state diffusion, or during the growth of poly itself, it can be doped by phosphine or diborane. Okay, we can add gases along with that, so process itself will dope it. Okay. However, as I say, rarely people do this, but I just thought it is possible. Why I wrote this specifically, because poly is also used particularly for RF and analog blocks as a resistors, but or even in memories, static RAMs. So in static RAM, the load many time is these days, because of variety of reasons, can be resistive. Even in EEPROMs, you need now some what we call interconnect switches, which also will require poly. So in those days, we will require doping. So this is one possibility how to dope a poly. So either during the growth or during depositions or by implant, or finally if you are bad enough everywhere, then do solid state diffusion. Okay. So till then we did this last time. Then I start now, or maybe I also did this, I am not sure. The first thing now I want to do is to create my gate, because this is the most important lithography, once again I will say, because this will decide the W by L of the transistors. Okay. So the etching here, delineation here of the gate is the most crucial factor in deciding the IE characteristics of the transistors, because here is where I am going to fix up my width and length of the channel. Okay, and therefore this is very crucial for me. So this step, though it is like any other lithography step, but it has to be handled very carefully, because it is here where if I make 10% error, I may make 100% error in my performance, and therefore I am really worried how much error I may, because then that will be shift everywhere, some transistor will not have even channels, proper channels. So we are worried here of masking correctly. And this is the step which takes care of your circuit performance requirements. We have deposited resist as usual and etched out the resist by developing, etched out the poly wherever I don't want gate. Okay. So you can see from here, this and this gates are, let's say, to be connected in CMOS. So where they will connect, get connected? Inside the plane. Okay. I mean, if you go down on the plan, then I can connect like this. Is that clear? Or what I should say, if you see a normal CMOS inverter, this is what we, this is a P channel. So this gate connection actually is on the, because this is a circuit, but on a cross section, I cannot show these 2 points, because if I am taking across something here, I cannot show the connection, but this connection is also possible during this masking itself. So connection between two gates is also possible during this lithography itself. Okay. So you should learn this plan, elevation, cross sections, side elevations, whatever it is. Okay. So once this, many a times, yeah, there are possibilities of some options people do for reliability. Some people actually retain the old oxide if they are already done good gate oxide before. Some do not, and they really etch out. So there were PhD thesis from Stanford which proved that having a fresh oxide is better. Okay. For just this, a PhD. Okay. So think of it, why so crucial. Okay, after this, the first thing we want to do is what we call as for the short channel devices, particularly for the channel length less than 90 nanometer or 0.1 microns. Actually less than a micron itself, all short channel effects are seen, but at least below 0.35, 0.25, you will certainly see huge number of problems. So one of the problems which we say is due to the scaling, the voltages are not getting scaled, where our lengths and widths are, okay. So the electric field across the gate oxides as well as across the source drain regions are not scaled down by same proportion as widths and lengths. And because of that, the electric field enhances everywhere, okay. That is our major worry, because as a reduced channel length and if voltage is not scaled, V by L will increase as comparative to normal scale device. And this enhanced fields both across the gate and across the lateral channel has an issue which has to be sorted out, because this additional electric field at the corner of drain, particularly one finds that it may allow carriers actually to go into the gate oxide. Okay, this is one reason how EEPROMs are written. This is the process of EEPROM writing, which may happen without your actually wanting. If charges go into gate oxide, what is the worst thing may happen? The threshold will shift. So everything is moving away from what you are designed for. So most crucially, you must realize that this LDD called lightly doped drain structure, so to reduce the electric field near the drain and also on the source side, of course there is a method in which asymmetric, they say source side will not do but only on the drain side, it's called asymmetric LDDs, but right now standard process both sides. So a lightly drained dope, you have a depletion width. Please remember, depletion width is proportional to 1 upon root n, okay. Now lighter this, the depletion width will larger. So it will not be concentrated near the drain, but it will also be spreading below the lower regions of the drain and surface regions. That means the electric field at the corners will be comparatively lower as compared to shorter depletion widths. This issue is very important in most short channel effect device. The other problem of course is what we call channel length modulations. The third problem is dibble, which is called drain induced barrier lowering. Professor Vasi, we asked much more on this before I start, because otherwise I start teaching that course, which I don't want to. So if I am really looking for my problem on short channel, I must do something, and one of the possibility is to do lightly doped drain structures. Then another thing which I have shown here is also called HALO, which also is for the same reasons, at least to reduce the depletion width going too far away. So this is called limiters, okay. But in this case there is no HALO shown. The basic process is that, please remember what we are trying is, at the drain end, we want N plus P plus to occur for N channel, P channel, because that is where the resistance is going to be, okay. So I want source and drain should have very highly doped regions, but very highly doped regions may create higher fields at the drain end, because source will be grounded, so drain will be essentially have huge fields. So to spread out that field, I will reduce the doping near the drain, and that process is what we call as lightly doped drains, okay. So what we do is we actually mask, let's say I am making first for N channel device, so I mask this envelope area and then do some phosphorus implants, okay. And since all implants will follow, of course this you can see here, I have not kept poly covered. Since it is N and I am looking for N channel, so even if it goes into poly, I am satisfied, okay. So I may mask that as well, but I don't, because I say it is a N plus poly, I may as well let it go. But in this case also it may happen, I may also have a P, so I may have to compensate during N plus P plus that this P which I unnecessarily got there has to be first compensated. So there is another people who actually mask this area, gate mask, so they put resist keep there and then implant. So there are methods which need additional mask, additional problems, but otherwise can be done. So since you can see it will follow H, and during its little drive-in cycle it will get inside the gate little bit, okay. Similarly, I mask the PL area for N channel device and then I open for P channel device and I do boron implants. P Please remember this dotted line was what was that? This was the threshold correction substrate, equivalently saying substrate for the device. Well is not my substrate, the substrate I created. Above which shallow implants. So I have a P plus, instead of P plus what? P implant I will do. That is lightly doped P, lightly doped N, and therefore arsenic was not put there, phosphorus was put. I was worried that it should not become N plus a priori. Okay. So that is the trick. Okay. And energy should be smaller because I do not want deeper implants. Okay. Having done this, both then of course I may do arsenic implant for N plus or this. Some people also do arsenic instead of phosphorus, but I am not the one who suggests that. Okay. Then you can see both masks are complementary. Okay. So I can keep same mask. Resist change, same resist, mass complementary, either way it can be done. So now I have both sides LDD structure for N channel device as well as P channel device, lightly doped regions have been created. Please remember gate is protecting it, below that is the channel area, there is no LDD, no doping, which is only, what is the doping in the channel? Only the implant which you have done for threshold corrections. Okay, that is the only implant there. Is that okay? Just for the sake of this word hello, hello implants are very word, it suggests something. Another sheets which you can see mask, maybe should I do sixth? This is an hello implant. What is hello is essentially what we have done is that earlier P or N implant for threshold is there, then we did LDD, but before the LDD started, we actually have another implant. And that implant is the substrate implant. Is that clear? Hello is made for substrates. Hello is not N plus P plus, but it is for the substrate corners. This was your substrate, and I have made another implant there. Is that okay? And this is, please remember, for N plus source and drain extension, of course, we will create, but we will have hello of what kind? Boron. Okay. Boron is also a P well here, so boron is the same as P well. There was already P threshold corrections, but this implant is not in the channel, this is just at the edge of the channel. So below the LDD implants, you actually have hello implants, then LDD implants. Is that clear? First you have hello implants, which is same as well, and then you are opposite of that. To make LDD, your NRP implants. Is that point clear? Hello is same as substrate implants, I mean as the well implants. So if you have P well, you have hello of P type. If you have N wells, you have hello of N type. Okay. This is called hello. This essentially is trying to create edges of the depletion region restricted only to that much place. Okay. A good figure may be coming and then see. So this is what hello I have done for. So this is a, what is SD implant? SD means LDD. SD implant is essentially in this, what he has written, extension as is called. Extension is for LDD. So SD is also, it will be always N plus P plus for N channel, P channel. Not plus, but N or P. Whereas hellos will be the well implants. Please remember this part. The hello is essentially substrate. Additional corner doping for the substrate. Okay, is or the wells at the edge of source entry. Similar argument you can see from here. So I can also do now the other, you can do P plus implant for source drain or P implant for source drain and N for hello. Is that clear? N well means N for hello and P plus P implants for source and drain. Same way for the other side. So I have made hello prior to my LDD this. Is that clear? So it's a prior step. And you don't need additional mask. This is important. You don't need additional mask. During whenever I was doing this, I did right there both these processes. So how do I do it? I just change the source and I just change the energies. Is that clear? So one I want deeper, the halo has to be slightly deeper. So I have a little higher energy, and in the case of N or P LDDs, I'll have a lighter energy because I want the surface. Is that clear? Red color is N N or P for N channel, P channel device, which is the source and drain?
LDD.
Why it is bluish region? This is, hello, this is well, whatever well, that's the same implant. Is that clear to you? This fact has to be understood. The many times people ask, hello. Hello word was used for something like this. Maybe I can show you why it was called hello. It creates a some peculiar shape and it gives as if there is an image of something shown. So first time an ACM picture was taken, the word was found, oh, it looks like an hello around. Okay. So this word picked up from an ACM picture. So don't give any other credence to it. There is no word, essentially no expansion of HALO or something. It is essentially when the SEM was, when the cut picture was seen, so someone said, oh, it is, it looks hello around source drain. So okay, so it's what the word is. So please get into it, how word starts, but now it has caught up. Okay. Now it has caught up. This is called hello implant. Of course, as I say, there are many other like the circuit, the technology which I chose from somewhere else, they have what is called raised source and drains. This is another process step, but right now forget about that. I just wanted to show what is in hello, why the word was given hello. Okay. Because when I see that, I did not see uniform this. I say when all around, oh, I say it's helloing all around. Okay. Hello is a word which you say like, most Indian gods, they show some hello around his face, you know, backside, same hello. Okay. Okay, so having shown you, then the next process step, so far we did LDD, so far we did hello if needed. Then I do spacer. Spacer, as I said last time, I discussed it, but now I will show you where is it. Now, after this, I actually deposit on the wafer, SiO2 deposit word, please remember, even it can be even nitride. In most places, earlier ones, we used to deposit silicon dioxide. It can be even nitride. Okay. That process of deposition of SiO2 is through low pressure CVD. So this technique we have to learn. What is how to do low pressure CVD? And the process step, if you wish, is silane is the gas used for silicon. So silane plus oxygen is SiO2 plus 2H2, or if you are using dichlorosilane, then SiH2Cl2 plus the oxidant is N2O. Okay, so SiH2N2O is SiO2 plus 2N2 plus 2HCl. Normally, I prefer not to have chlorine around. Chlorine has some advantages and some great disadvantages. In the 80s, when everyone started, everyone thought chlorine will do wonders. We have actually spent 3 years to put chlorine inside and finally learned that it has not done as good as what we thought, all of us. Many years, TCA was trying, pure chlorine was trying, HCl oxidation was tried to improve the NIT or DIT of the MOS structure, and finally we realized it does reduces, but it creates more traps. So, ek tarah ka advantage, dusra disadvantage. So, which is better? So, mostly silane will be used. The only difficulty with, of course, even dichlorosilane is poisonous, but not greatly poisonous. Silane is not really poisonous, but it is extremely flammable. You are this era, so probably you will not learn, you will not be knowing. Earlier in English, anything which is flammable used to be called inflammable. Inflammable. Okay, so now after this outside is this, I want to create side walls for the gate. So you can see from here, oxide walls, the wire deposition process is important because deposition is normally, LPCVD in particular, is conformal. What is conformal word means? It follows the last contour. If something has to climb, it will climb. If it goes down, it will go down. Okay, so it's a conformal process. Since it is conformal oxide, what does it mean? Thickness, every point is roughly the same. Every point thickness grown is roughly the same. Okay. That has an advantage and disadvantage. Disadvantage is if I do it some normal etching in chemical, not only this oxide will go, everything may go away. So I want to restrict that etching process only to all other area except this side walls. So I figured out that if I somehow do etching, which is anisotropic, vertically down, and I say, okay, I protect, I etch this oxide on the top, let us say some T oxide there. I also can etch T oxide here, but in this side is how much? 2 T ox. Is that clear? Here is a T ox, here is a T ox. At this step, there is a 2 T ox. So, if my agent is ionic agent is such that it only can etch T ox, then for example, right figure which you can see, this will etch down and this will etch on this side. But the side wall, it will not, because it was twice there. Is that clear? So, the upper portion goes away, lower portion goes away, this goes away, but space between the side walls of gate, you always find oxide retained. That is called spacer. Is that point clear? Why it is possible? Because I am etching down and I believe that the way I etch it, I will only etch T ox only. Okay. So, upper T ox gone, in between also oxide, but sideways there is no way because ions were etching only vertically down. Okay. And therefore, I can create a spacer. This is what last time I discussed. Spacer has its own advantage. It does have some little bit of disadvantage as well. There is something called boron depletion, which is another worry, but some other day. Okay. So once this sidewall formation has been done, so do you think we have not used additional marks so far? Is that clear? I deposited oxide and I etched it. So there is no mask so far used by me. I whatever last 7, 6 or 7, whichever number I had, how much, which was the number then? I just don't know. Which was the last number? We have 5th mask. No, not 5th. 8th mask we have done. So we have still not gone for the 9th mask. Still we have done now gate, we have white spacer, we have LDD, we are hello, but mask is only till 8th. We have done almost everything what really device needs. Okay. So why 20 or 16? So itne mein ho gaya na, nahi hota abhi. Okay. Now first thing we have to do is, please remember the purpose of hello. Let us say next step, what is the source drain implant I should have? Very heavily dosed and fill up, it should fill up everything, so that the if larger the depth, what is the better thing? The resistivity, the conductivity will be higher, or therefore contact resistance will be lower, the sheet resistance will be lower, everything will go fair if I make deeper this. But the technology may not allow now deeper source drains, okay, because there is a sidewall capacitance issue. So I want to reduce that. That means at least the minimum I should do is heavily dope that region. I cannot reduce now, increase the junction depths, because that I will be barred. I will be scaling it down for sake of capacitances. So if I reduce that, I will have increase. That is one problem which everyone is facing. Smaller nodes, the source drain depths are smaller, thinner. And because of that, the resistance of source drain is not smaller now. Okay, compared to earlier, when I have 2 micron junction, I have very low resistance. Now I have a 2000 angstroms or less, then I have much higher resistance at the source and drains. So the minimum I want is the surface concentration should be as high as possible. Okay. Okay, so I do now source drain implant. So first I do for N channel device. So I mask the N-well area for P channel area. And doing this, I open all region wherever N transistor is going to come, and that deep enough is what? Because it should be at least filling up the complete source drain areas. If it is very shallow, it will only go to the surface. There was a P implant you did, hello implant you did. I want every area there be filled up with N plus. Is that pretty clear? I have made a implant for threshold, then I have made a halo, and then I also have a sidewall N or P there, N. I want all that side on the left hand side of the gate should be heavily doped. So I must have deep enough and higher dose implants so that becomes N plus strong enough. Okay. so that my resistance is smaller. Is that clear? Why my resistance is worrying me? This is a drain and source resistance in a transistor. If you see it, even in analog for example, one of the major worries of this source resistance is what? Anyone? Gain. It's a common emitter with source, what is called as degenerated source. The gain will be RD by RE or RD by RS. If RS is present there, the gain can never increase, maybe 4, 5, 8, I want 100. So this source resistance in analog is very crucial for us, okay. However, therefore, we never go for 22 nanometers. Sorry, I will work 0.25, 0.35, 90, bahut ho gaya to 65, okay, that's it. So typical energies they are given for the process, which is 0.25 micron process, is 2 into 10 to the power 15 per centimeter square. Please remember, we talk about doses. Is that clear? Depths are decided about the energy. So we only talk of dose, and dose is decided about the current collected at the integral IGT. What we are is our dose. So dose is what we are deciding, and not the energies decide the depth. Dose decide the amount of impurities I can push inside. Okay. So I adjust my dose. Also there is a word which is important, is this source drain also may get another contact on the top, because it is silicon right now. So I will put some metal on that for making a contact, and it should form a good alloy between the two. It is called silicidation. Okay. With poly, what it is called? If I make a contact with poly, salicidation. Silicon we call silicidation, polysilicon we call salicidation. So silicidation process is going to happen on source drains. Some metal will actually react with source drain. So it will eat up some silicon, is that clear? It will eat up some silicon, which means your depth should be sufficient enough that this silicidation process does not take all of it. So there is no halo, there is nothing left there. So you have to be a little careful. These are all design issues, process design issues. Typical energy, he says, is 75 kV, and this was what impurities will do. Arsenic, why? N plus plus, okay, 10 to power 21 I can go, 4 into 10 to power 21 is higher solubility, I can reach there, okay. Of course in, yes, it's a name given, polysalicides. Yeah, but this, I am not saying this in this process itself. The process, there is a separate salicidation process for ROMs. So some other day, some other technology. The word used there, if you read somewhere salicidation, don't get worried. It is essentially they are talking of polysalicides. Okay. That's why I just said a number name to you. Okay. It will still not, because the solid solubility limit is coming at a temperature, you are right, but that is the limit up to which no material get. What is that? It still remains crystalline. So you, if you have too much of a dose trying, the damage which it will create will not be restored. Okay. So essentially there is a limit which is close to solid solubility limit. Is that, that's why you go to 1000 degrees centigrade to anneal it. Okay. So that it reaches maximum recovery as well as full dose. Okay. Use the opposite mask, opposite resist, whichever way you think of. Right now do for boron doping for P plus, okay, which is again the same technique. Why boron has lower energy? The range of boron is longer for same energy. So you think of it that we discussed earlier, we have shown you that number has been used there, 70 kV to 50 kV. Typically dose is something 10 to power 15 or 16 per centimeter square. Okay. So now I have made N plus, P plus, okay. I have made channel stoppers, I have made halos, I have made LEDs, okay. I have made everything what a transistor needs, okay. I have almost made my both N channel and P channel device. So what should be the next thing I need? I need to make something contact to all regions so that I can externally create a circuit out of that, okay. After this implants, which is normally high dose implant, and particularly for arsenic, the damage will be higher. So what should be the anneal cycle? at least should be higher temperature, little 30 minutes anneal are essential for recoveries. And what is the advantage of recovery during that? The impurities will also get substitutional, so it is good to happen there. So there is a final anneal, as the word says, it is a high temperature drive-in, it activates the implanted dopants, diffuses junctions to their final depths, typically 30 minutes 900 or say 1 minute RTA. RTA is rapid thermal anneal, and 1000 degree is tried, so that now I have a source drain, I have a halo, of course not shown here, halo plus LDD plus gate is also doped during those regions. Okay, so my transistors are ready. Okay, now I need, as I said, the contacts. I need a contact from the source, contact from the drain, contact from the gates. Okay, so I need contacts everywhere, because unless I take out a contact out of it, I cannot actually connect externally anywhere. Okay, on the wafer. So this next thing is, first thing is whatever is the additional oxide here, there, you give a very, what actually even not HF dip, it is called buffered HF dip. Say it is 10 to 1 or 100 to 1 HF diluted, and you actually give 1 second swab, as it is called, dip it and take it. Okay. It removes all the surface, everything what is sticking around. The idea is not to disturb any of the other oxides, okay, side walls, nothing should change. So it actually, whole rack is dipped into bath and taken away. Okay. Of course, not by hand, by machine. It just goes in and goes up. Okay, and then water is immediately poured on it. Okay, so that then dried and everything else. Okay, so this is essential. We are now ready for this process, which I finished now. Maybe a little more. First contact, of course, we'll do. It's called front end process. What is it called? Till the first contact, we are not finished that, but till the first contact is made for source drain, the process is called front end processing. Okay. That means for any circuit, irrespective of whatever circuit you are looking for, this process will be constant, except W bias, but that is decided. So I have made transistors, have given W bias, I have brought first contact to source drain and everywhere. And now what is the next thing you have to do is to create interconnects between number of such transistors the way you want circuit to perform. Is that clear? You want to make a flip-flop, you connect some other way. You want to make an adder, you mark some other way. You use, but these transistors are available to you with their basic connections out for any connection possibility. Is that clear to you? So this is means why it was called front-end, because front-end processes are constant. For a given technology node, this will be a constant process, okay, no changes. But backend, which is the one which starts, backend means the interconnect parts ahead, is the decision of a circuit man. Okay, circuit people are telling what you want. So that is called backend processing. Okay, so the first contact, now I have to do it. It is titanium silicide contact to source and drain, and titanium nitride as a barrier creation. Of course, there are, earlier we used to make even aluminium, okay, as the first contact itself. Aluminium has all good things, in fact. I mean, people always say, why suddenly you went for titanium? Two reasons we went to titanium. Aluminium has a problem of when they are very thin, they electromigrate very fast. And some other day we'll discuss this. So since it's a very strong electromagnetic material, also it oxidizes very, it's good, because actually that's how your all grills, everything are anodized, means passivated, that means it becomes alumina. So it's so strongly oxygen affinity for aluminium, and aluminium oxide is an insulator, is that correct? So we don't want insulator to be contact, okay, so we wanted metallic contact. So aluminium is not so strong contender. Earlier we had a thicker aluminium, so we had no problem. Now when everything was reducing, this aluminium has a pinhole problem, aluminium has an oxidation problem, then we said, okay, give it up. Okay. So aluminium was declared person a non grata, and copper was replacing aluminium. Okay. Aluminium has a good thermal conductivity and it has a good electrical conductivity. That is the two things we are looking for, good thermal conductivity and good electrical conductor, aluminum has all of it. Okay, so we deposited titanium. Deposition what, please take it, is coplanar, it always forms the contours. I said just now, copper is replacing aluminiums. Wherever there, we are copper interconnects. Copper has disadvantage. Copper has gives a two levels in silicon, okay. So which are traps, so it may kill your mobilities. So we must protect copper from silicon. So at least first interconnect cannot be copper. Is that clear? It has to have something else. Second, third, ten, you can go for copper. Copper also has a problem. It has a very strong diffusivity in oxide. So one has to put some kind of a clad. Clad means some kind of a jacket wherever copper goes. You have seen a wire. It's always inside a this copper wire. It oxidizes also very fast. So it needs a jacketing. So additional process. This process was found by many companies and everyone claimed patents. It's called Damson process. Maybe we should discuss later. Okay. Copper cladding with copper interconnects. Okay. There is where that vanadium oxide was worked, okay, as a clad. Okay, so I deposited titanium everywhere. Okay. Then this process of deposition generally is by a process called sputtering. Okay. The process which we will discuss is sputtering. Okay. It's also one way of deposition metal films. One of course is evaporation, the other is sputtering. After this titanium has been deposited, we actually allow it to react with nitrogen ambient to form a titanium nitride layer on the top. Okay. Wherever this, please remember, formation of some silicon is consumed, source drain junction should be deep enough. This word is, I keep saying, why source drain junctions are very important, that deep, how much deep? You want that some silicon will go away, and that's why I wrote again for this, that source drain depths are very crucial in present technologies. Well, little less, there is no source. Little more, it lost the conductivity issues. Okay. So here the issue which is very difficult to, and that you people learn by experience. Source drain junction should be deep enough to allow titanium silicide as a good conductor which gives low contact resistance with source and drain. That's why titaniums are used in fact. It actually forms titanium silicide and it's an alloy. Okay, it's an alloy, and that can be done by using one. On the top of this, I actually pass nitrogen and create titanium nitride on that. Titanium nitride is also a good conductor, luckily. It's a great thing that titanium nitride is also, actually is better than titanium silicide as a conductor, running conductor, okay. Because creating a titanium silicide everywhere uniformly is difficult, okay. Alloying can be only restricted areas, but nitride can run anywhere, okay. So this so-called whatever pink color or orange color is titanium nitride, okay. And this process normally is not furnace anneals, generally it is RTA, because 1 minute everything can be achieved. Okay. Temperatures are 600 to 700. Please remember, in VLSI this is thing has happening. All processes should be now lower and lower temperature, because whatever earlier you have done, that should not get disturbed with this additional temperatures. So next processing, if implant has been annealed at 1000 or 900, no process next should happen for 900, because that DT product should not get added there. Is that clear? So the next processing ahead will always be lower temperature than the main implant's process temperatures. Okay. Having created nitride, having silicide and everything done, we use the mask 11 to remove the nitride from the areas which you don't want. I only want nitride to be connected to the source drains and maybe one of this, and this contact may be internal to it, okay, which is not shown here. This so called orange one on nitride, these are resist. You etch out the nitride from everywhere. People who wish to know, nitride agent is ammonia, NH4OH plus H2O, 2H2O. Where do you use this agent? In silicon cleaning. Do you remember I say HCl plus, one is acidic cleaning, other is basic. This is the same process, okay. So we remove titanium nitride in this normal 1:1:5 agent, and then we also remove, please remember my worries are essentially that the spacer should not retain nitride. So that is where the whole game was, that that's why chemical agent was used, because I want from everywhere nitride to go except the regions where I actually looking for interconnects. Is that point clear? Why the weight etching is done here and not ionic etching? Dry etching was not tried because I want nitride to go from everywhere else. Is that clear to you? Because it's an interconnect and it's not a contact to source drains. Is that correct? It's an interconnect running. You have a titanium nitride silicides as the contacts, but outside to that I am running nitride layer, titanium nitride layer. This has to be understood, and therefore you need a mask so that titanium nitride is removed from all places except interconnect regions. Okay. That's why this is a important step. You can see from here everywhere we removed titanium nitride. Otherwise, if it is a coplanar, it will also go everywhere, and if you protect, it will also remain there. So I want to remove from every other place. Then if I want a multi-level metal, and now this is what I say, front end is old. Okay. First metal has come, front end. The now what we start is back end starts. We also do a conformal layer of oxide now again. I deposit silicon dioxide, okay, typically around a micron, this blue one, which goes everywhere. Conformal means it sees the contours. It's a LPCVD process. Normally either the phosphosilicate glass or borosilicate glass were tried, but of late people are trying what is called as borophosphosilicate glass, which has both boroglass as well as phosphoglass. The advantage people figured out is the following. Phosphorus has a tendency to actually tag on to sodium. Phosphosilicate glass will tag to sodium. It will not allow sodium move. Where boron actually will allow, because you know you have a glass which is there and you want to planarize later. So I want glass to be little liquefied. I won't say liquefied, it is called reflow. So it's slightly molten state. Borosilicate has a lower temperature reflow compared to phosphor. So if I add a borosilicate when I actually want to planarize, I'll have reflow at lower temperature. So I use borosilicate along with phosphosilicate. It's a mixture. So it is also given a name, borophosphosilicate glasses. So once I do this, which is the blue colored this, the first thing I do is to use a process which we discussed last time, is called chemical mechanical polishing, CMP. This was not in our times. Now this is very common process. The wafers, let's say if this is your wafer surface, the polish is done like this on the chuck, which has a slurry, silica slurry, which is normally has in some higher pH means what, acidic or basic? Basic. Higher pH means basic. So slurry is slightly basic, more basic than, it should not be acidic, because acidic will attack everything. So pH should be higher enough, so you keep maintaining some ammonium hydroxide solutions around, and there is a constant dip pH monitor is going on, you keep adding automatically. So using this, the way wafers are mounted on a chuck and actually polished mechanically, not by hand, by machine, and that essentially removes the top layers. The earlier versions, please just a minute, we have a non-planar surface. Is that clear? Now please remember, we have gone through so many process steps, everywhere steps are different heights. Okay. So we are now to make at least the top of the wafer one plane. Like this. This is called, by using a CMP process, I can planarize. Okay. Is that okay? This planarization is a crucial process step. Now, so far how many masks? 11. Now here is a 12th mask. I want to make contacts to this titanium nitride. So I must protect all other, even on titanium nitride, titanium silicide. I want contact to gate, I want contact to source, I want contact to drain. So I must open all those regions where the second metal should actually come and make contact to that. These are called, either called holes or called vias, V I A, what is that called? Vias. So I must create vias. How do I, in what material I should create vias? Only in resist is good enough. So first I will actually create resist and I create via and then etch out all other oxides from region where contact is to be made. Is that clear? I removed from the gate, I removed from nitride, I removed, of course here I did not show, maybe backside and maybe here. Wherever I want a contact to the next layer, I must open a window connection to that. What is being etched in mask? Oxide. Please remember, masking is always done in oxide. Okay. So this will delineate what? The contact regions. Okay. This will, now this depth of vias what we are creating is also a crucial. How much thick oxide should be? Okay. If it is too thin, the capacitance is very high. See, Teox is lower. If it is too thick, the via deep depth is too high, and then next process may create problem. So depth of via is decided by how much CMP I do and what I retain as my actual oxide thickness. Is that point clear? Too thick a thickness of resist, I mean oxide I keep, the vias are too deep and the next metal may not go properly. If it is too thin, between two layers, if the oxide is too thin, they will interconnect. Okay, they will connect itself by capacitance at high frequency, 1 upon j omega c. So my worries are how much. So this circuit people will say this is the frequency they will operate. So I will accordingly adjust my oxide thickness. Okay, so the next process step, I then after the contact is done, I actually have another titanium nitride as the next layer of contact. Okay, please remember before the this pinkish layer is actually tungsten. Please just listen to me. This pink layer is a tungsten, but below that there is a thin layer of titanium nitride which I deposited, which is not so much visible because it was below that. No, there is no, of course in this region you can see, but even everywhere we will find one thin layer of titanium nitride which over which the tungsten is going to sit. The titanium nitride has some interesting features. It's a layer, typically 100 angstroms are what we do, and it acts like a barrier. Firstly, it has an excellent adhesion with silicon dioxide. Titanium nitride makes a good adhesion. Okay, so that's what we are looking for. The other is it is a barrier between tungsten and the lower material, lower regions. Okay, it should act between the two, buffer. So titanium nitride is a buffer between tungsten and any other metal. Okay, so everywhere wherever I run tungsten, below that there will be a thin layer of titanium nitride, and that will be typically 100 angstroms. Okay, how to deposit tungsten? Tungsten fluoride, hexafluoride, treated with hydrogen at around 450 degrees centigrade can reduce it to tungsten and HF. Now this tungsten's, then I remove this tungsten. Please remember this is also conformal because it was deposited. This is a CVD. So what do I do is, I go through another CMP process. How much? As much as the thickness of tungsten was. So if I remove this top portion of tungsten, I get only tungsten just on the contact points where do you want. These are called tungsten plugs. What are they called? Plugs. So we create tungsten plugs. Where do you create tungsten plug? Wherever contact you want above for the second metal, you must create between the lower metal and the upper metal. The connectivity is through tungsten, and this W by L of this tungsten via is decided by the contact resistance and the net resistance you can tolerate. Okay. Okay, so once I etch out the, or rather I remove the tungsten from the top surface, I have another planar surface available. And why this is always possible? CMP allows me to grind things, so that I should know up to where I have to grind. So I finish that process. So I get this process which these people are talking. This first titanium silicide is not called first interconnect. The first interconnect is now going to come. Okay. Here they are shown aluminium, but could be copper. I did not want to show copper because there is another process I have to show, which I will show later. So this is essentially first metal is aluminium. How many metal layers you may expect? As large as 7, okay, and maybe someday 10. Why do you need so many interconnects? Because if there are 1 billion transistor on chip, okay, for one single circuit, how many, or particularly if it is a DSP based some kind of a circuit, there is only interconnects. There are no great circuit devices. It's only here to there. Data going from here, here to here, here, some filter, some adder, some, it keeps doing running around. LLHH, HLLH filtering is going on, and so interconnects are extremely heavy. Now, because of such things, and we know two metals certainly will not like to do like this. If one metal is going here, so it should be at least thick enough oxide and I run something on this. Preferably I will say, okay, don't run this everywhere, don't run in between, I run. So if I decide that I will not run over everywhere as much as possible, I will require much more space to run the interconnects. The, at least what I will do is one should not interact with 3, 3 should not interact with 6 or 5. Then next nearest neighbor it should not interact. The below it goes above, it's okay, 2 thickness of oxide and it's saved by you. But at least the nearest neighbor on the top or bottom should not get connected. So run metal layer should not run one over the other as much as possible. And this needs number of metal layers, okay, so that we avoid connection going from crossing one over. Okay, so this is, and since I did is aluminium, not because I wanted it, but this is what plumber's book has, so I thought I will show you. But nowadays, aluminium will be replaced by copper. But the only problem then is, as I say, aluminium does not require any cladding. I may have to create vanadium, some kind of a clad around in which copper should sit. Okay, so there is another game going on. Okay, so maybe I will show you Damson process. So I deposit metal, and what do? Wherever that interconnect I want to retain, okay, I put photoresist, etch aluminium from elsewhere. So which resist I should, let's say I am using PPR. So what kind of mass it should, I repeat, I want to retain aluminium certain regions, but I want aluminium be removed from all other regions. I am using PPR, okay, clear field mass. Why clear? Because wherever light will go, photoresist will be softened out. So aluminium will be easy to etch out there because there will not be resist there. The rest area where I am protecting, the PPR light should not go, and therefore it should be. So that is, I repeat, the mask is decided or resist is decided. Generally companies prefer one mask type or one resist type. They don't keep changing resist and mask, generally, not necessarily. So which is this number mass for aluminium? 13th mass has been used to do first metal. If I want the second metal, what should I do again? I should deposit oxide again. If you need plugs, you put plugs also, then polish it, and then again put the second metal layer. Create mask, 14th mask on that, etch out the 14th layer. So here is one, second metal is another oxide, and you can see another plug has been created. Wherever I will go from one metal to the lower metal, that tungsten plug has to be created. And tungsten plug can only be created by which? It must have titanium nitride below it before. So the same processing is done. First I deposit nitride and then I deposit in the same CVD, actually I do it. It's called co-CVDs. So it's not actually CVD, it's a molecular beam epitaxy. Some other word, I can do one after the other. If I am doing LP-CVD, I have two reactors. I'll have to do twice. Load lux. So abhi apne aan hai. This is second metal. If I want third, what do I do? Etch out this. Put dump another oxide, put create vias, titanium nitride, tungsten, put new metal, put another, keep doing as many metal layers as you wish to, okay. So for example, he said another two of them may be final. The last, after number of metals are over, there is the last mask is used, okay. This is called the, generally the layer on the top, which is shown here for example, is silicon nitride, okay. This is very important. Two things, silicon nitride is a relatively hard material. What does that mean? So during handling, it does not get scratched down any silicon area. It will actually protect the silicon wafer. So nitride, the second part of nitride is, it is an excellent passivating material. It does not allow any sodium, potassium or any other species or even water molecules to get inside. It is not hygroscopic. So because of that, the last layer of the chip is nitride. But you need now another mask for what? Final contacts will go on the chip, I mean this package. So you need pad patterns to be opened, and opened where? Nitride is etched only at the pad patterns and nowhere else. Pad is the last mask. So you have pad pattern which is now opened in nitride, and that is actually put it into the packaging. And therefore, either wire bonded or by bumps bonding, flip chip, and I can make final packaging of the chip. So, last mask, irrespective whatever number of masks you did earlier, should be a passivation mask, and normally it is, and it should be very thin and very good nitride. So, it is plasma enhanced CVD. One of the CVD process which you use is plasma enhanced CVD. Is that point clear to you? So how many masks I did? 16 for the sake of 2 metals. You add 5 more metals, so 5 minimum will go there, okay. Why 5? You may need more for the plugs. So you think of it, you add anything, you have additional mass for everything you go ahead of this. Is that correct? So don't think that why not 20 mass this. 20, another thing you must remember, at no time the topmost metal or the metal should go more than one layer down connection. Is that clear? This connectivity is clear. I cannot connect 7th layer to 1 at any time directly. So don't create a via of 7 layers. There is no possibility of anything going through this, okay. So what we will do is from 7 to 6, 6 to 5, 5 to 4, 4 to 3. So keep shifting, okay. So the area is constantly varying because of where do you want which connection. So when you lay out a circuit, you must plan very well that you do not need 7 to 1 connection any time, okay. Is that clear? So the designers, when they create a layout, also should think what is the technology available and how many minimum connectivity is to be given. So it is not process person's job, it is the designer's job to give me a mask which will allow me less number of interlayer connectivity. But that means top to bottom I should not be asked to connect. Is that clear? I mean, I am not saying I cannot do it by like this zigzag I will, but that is not the best way of connectivity. So try your designs in a way, somewhere you use interconnectivity of poly, somewhere you use only local titanium nitride interconnect. So do not run everywhere from every other place to every other place. This is something designer has to plan well. Which layer I want next connection is that. So when you lay out, you must see colors there. I think, I hope they are, he has already come on layout. Has he? Has he shown some layers to you? So you must have seen poly, red, this. Essentially those colors are masks for me. Each color is a mask for me. Okay. So at that time he should plan which connection when. Okay. And therefore that is the layout, that is the mask I will receive, that is the mask I will print. Okay. Is that clear? So designer's job doesn't end only on circuit simulation, okay, which many people believe. It's the layout which is the most limiting the success of the chip design. So layout should be very good, error free, good density with no irregularity issues in that, all that, and then you expect my technology to deliver what you are actually expecting, which I may not promise in one, but I may go second time in one run. These are called turnaround. Once I run through a mask, 16 masks, and my chip did not work. So the first time I'll go and verify, there are test areas, there are this, I'll test where I went. Am I, is the mass problem or my problem? Okay. Most problem, technology people will always say it's a mass problem. Designers say, hey, your process has a problem. These additional extensions are not mine. All statements are made, but finally you have to pay again for the second round, and finally success has to come. Okay. There are no designs in the world which has gone in first turnaround. There is always first turnaround. One turnaround is part of the game. This will be required. All designers design with a specifications, and they keep saying you, these are the technology people say, these are the things which you must follow, which are called design rules. You cannot separate diffusion less than this, put metal close to this. Every rule which I need, I'll inform him. So his layout will take care. Okay. And now there is an auto design checker. So it will not allow even to draw many times. Okay. You can force it. There is a bypass. You can overrule it. But normally DRC doesn't allow. Then why fail? Because this fail is something which humanly not possible. What designers tell the process people, technology has said rules, design rules. What technology people receive from data from designers, this you must give me. What is that he is asking? Technology has told, no, you can't do this, you can't do this, you can't do this. So I, the layout person, I say, okay, I have taken care. But what is something a designer keeps telling this man, this you must promise. What is that? He actually tells you the propagation time from source to drain, he actually specifies. Why propagation time? Because L by V is time, but V is mu E. Okay. So he is essentially telling this much minimum mobility I am expecting at the surface from you, because all my analysis was based on some mu. Is that clear? So the designers tell only one thing, the propagation time for an electron to go from source to drain. He said, I want a propagation time of 10 picoseconds. That's the only data he forces on you. So the process should hold to that number any day at all transistors. Is that clear? So please don't think that designers don't tell. Designers have very stringent force. They say, if you, even if 1% or 5% error you go, how much error I'll have, he'll have to calculate. So he has to always worry about speeds, and then he will only tell what they call as propagation time. So don't think only one sided this, there is a other side people keep telling that your device processing is not good enough to get this much mobilities, and I want for both P channel and N channel this much. Okay. And then only I can assure you my circuit will perform. Is that point clear to you? So don't anytime feel that things are very trivial. Any small, of course, we few of my PhD students worked on reliability issues, and we did figure out most processes will show you 10% variations. Okay. Now, either your designer should take care of 10% variations, or at least you should say some of the processes may actually damage you more than the others. So either there are techniques, statistical techniques. So you will have to do now statistical designs rather than what we called as fixed designs. So you must take care of variations, and these variations vary from technology node to company to company. This Monte Carlo method is not very good. That's what our results was. Monte Carlo says that number of variables as much you take, let's say you have 12 variables. So the pseudo random generation required 2 to the power 12 samples. So if you process it for a circuit with some 100 million transistors, some next year it will result come. Okay. So you can't use. So we figured out that 2 to the power something, instead of 2 to the into something, if I do say 2 to the power q and 2 into q, and q is large, I will do much smaller simulations, and will be only less than 0.01% away from Monte Carlo. Okay. So that is our technique to show that we can do analysis much faster for any large circuits. Or we may even assign which are the critical areas where circuit need not be worried too much. Okay. Slowest path. So you anyway, that is going to limit. So why are you forcing VT everywhere? only this area is limiting you. So first circuit person should talk with device and then to process, and each should translate where what, okay. Then you can make a better design. So square statistical designs. So nowadays most of the designs are statistical, okay. So this finishes 16 mask standard CMOS. Tomorrow being Wednesday, we will start with the three processes, or rather two processes which we talked, which we haven't done. One we said depositions, and in depositions also we said few different kinds. Sometimes are deposited metal, sometimes are deposited insulators. Okay. So I need to have a CVD, chemical vapor deposition, which can either deposit metals or this. And then I will have etching. I etch everywhere. Okay, so I need to know etching. So two processes will be. So tomorrow we start with CVD.